during my last exam level 3 after I walked out of the stadium where I wrote the exam, I was telling myself, I'm done. I'm done with taking another qualification or designation exam. I'm done. Everyone, so welcome back again to my channel. So this is actually the third installment of my original filming talking about my experiences with the CFA and the actual exams. So the first part is really talking about my journey going through the exams and why I decided to do CFA after getting my actual designation. So like comparisons between the two. And then part two, actually talk about 10 tips, 10 study tips, hopefully will help you to pass these professional exams. And this video will talk about like the Q&A that I receive on this topic that I want to clarify a little bit more, and hopefully you'll find them helpful. Most of them already from my previous comments, but a few questions I want to comment more about. So the first one is like, how much time needed for each CFA level? How many days off taken? What materials? Again, I think it really depends on your study, study ability, or how much time you want to set aside to study for the CFA exam. Especially like, you do have the option to take the exam whether in December for the level 1 and then right away June for level 2, or you just like do June for level 1 and then level 2 and then level 3. You don't have like an hour or like a whole year to prepare for the exam. So it's really like, know how much material you're already familiar, and a good way is actually take the practice exam right at the beginning, because then you will feel like, oh, do I know anything, or I completely, wow, these are like totally new material and I don't know anything, so I need more time to get ready. And it's again, also it's depend on, do you have any other things going on in your life, that like maybe you get a new job, maybe you have like some projects that are very important one that you want to prioritize. So it is, I do think it's like, it is a journey. This is not like a competition. Like, don't compare yourself to others. Compare to yourself, like to your own self, like your past, and getting it from like knowing like your own experiences, and then your own values, and then like prioritize and plan things accordingly. And I think you will be able to decide like how much time you really need to study for the exam. And it's okay if you don't pass for in the first time either. I think it's like, if you study hard, you and continue so, and then with the right techniques then it would help you in order to pass the next time. And then like, how many days taken and what material? So like for the actual exam, so I believe I was given 1.5 days for each hour of the exam. For the CFA exam, I did not get a study day, but I would get, I think for level 2, I think I took like a few days off, and then for level 3, like I took like a week off on my, using my vacation days for it. But yeah, like for the actual exams, like I usually use all of my study days for the last week or 2 weeks of the exam, in order to just like really stay focused, doing less push, connecting everything, and push me through to for the final exam. And for what material, for the level 3, for CFA exam, I didn't use anything besides the Swizer, like the final summary page. How I actually go through studying for an actual exam or like a CFA exam that about 5-6 hours long. So first, I will set out the schedule to see when I want to go through the first reading. And then when is next, like my second review, and when is my final review. So usually I will have 3 phases for that. So for the first reading, it will be maybe like 1 to 2 months. And I don't try to understand everything as during this phase, because I believe like sometimes it's just like, once you get exposed to the same concept multiple times, sometimes you get used to it, you accept it, or like sometimes it's like, it will make sense later on when you learn about other things. So during the first reading, I do not try to understand everything, and I do not try to memorize everything either. But I would try to like write down notes on, even like on the study menu, And having those would help me recall on like, oh, what I struggle, what I need to want to pay attention the next time. And then the second phase is when I go through those study manual notes. So if you study for actuary exam, you probably know, like, you can purchase study manual when they're making notes on the material, on the original material. So maybe the original material is 30 pages for that chapter or that article, but like the study manual notes will be maybe only 5 pages left. Right, so I already have like maybe some notes on that. So I would go through the study material, like the study manual notes and material and my own note on that, and do practice questions on that so that I can understand more on the different material. And then the last phase is like actually making the final notes from those study manuals. So it's like a funnel that like to help you go through all the material from like selecting what is the most important that, or like the key concept that you have to know, or like from those, like from 2000 pages, how you get that to 200 pages, and then how you get that, like maybe like just 10 pages left that you have to memorize. So this is where the last 2 weeks, is where I actually try to memorize everything to connect the dots. And really, that is like, I feel like sometimes it's just like one day I will have a light bulb that everything just makes sense to me, just connect the dots to me. And this is where like the last phase is where I memorize things and where I do practice questions or exam without looking at the materials or the notes, because like I would try to practice as if I'm writing the exam to get used to the how to write the exam on the day, and then to recall things as quick as possible. Like these exams are challenging because you have a lot of material again, and you only have a certain number of hours. You're not gonna have like all the time you want to recall everything. So the key thing is like, how can you recall the information or the knowledge that, like the information that you have, as quickly, as efficiently as possible? And for like the level 2 or level 3 exams, or like the upper actuary exam, is like how you can apply the knowledge into practical situations. So they want to test your understanding of the material and not just like memorization. So it's important that you really understand what are the key concepts or the key information that the exam trying to test you about. So thinking of it on a bigger picture is very helpful. And that's really where, like I say about like connecting the dot of like what this exam really trying to test you about. How many exams to take? And I think these questions come from someone is taking the exam through the IFOA. So from talking to Ranvia from Ranvia channel, she's mentioned that like for IFOA, it's like you have 2 sittings per year, and you can take like 1 or 2 or 3 exams per sitting. And for the SOA, exam is different because like summer exam, they offer like 4 to 6 times per year, like the probability day. And then the upper actual exam, like for the FSA track, like they only offer like 2 per year back then when I took them. So I don't know anyone take 2 exams at the same time, because like you can plan it so that you would just like take, oh, maybe the probability exam when they have like 6 times, you do it in February, and then the next exam you could do it again in after 2 months and so on. So none of us take 2 exams per sitting. We only take 1 exam per sitting. But when you think about it in that sense, it means that each 6-month period, we brought some like for the special preliminary exam, somebody can go through like a total of maybe 6 hours exams in total. So that may equate to like 2 exams under the IFOA track. So like I think once you like at a 6-hour exam, that's a lot of material already, and you have to study it in within only like 5 or 6 months. Taking more than that, I think it's very challenging. And we also have like some module for the SO exam. So some people will be like doing is that like we would take the modules, and it's like on our own pace, and it is assignment. There's no like final exam or anything. So you can supplement it, like you can do it at the beginning during the period that while waiting for the exam result. And then the like after like within the 6 months, so the first like 2 months when you have to wait for the exam, you can do the module. And then the next 4 months, you focus on studying for your actual exams, especially for the upper one.
Okay,
I'm working on CFA, but I'm so afraid it is not so useful for my career. It makes me anxious. So I think it is, I guess it's like what career path you would like to pursue. Like having a CFA from like another interview I have with somebody who has a CFA and also did a master of quantitative finance. It's like, I do agree with him. Having a CFA sometimes is like a free qualifier for you to get into certain areas. Well, at least having like CFA level one is aimed first about that. And some jobs do require you to have a CFA. So it really depends on the job. And then also it's like, for some people, like me, I feel more confident when I have the qualification, like an official structure designation to show that I have gone through the material and then I was able to pass, to obtain that knowledge. So it gave me a confidence. So when, and some people, it doesn't mean a thing for them. And it's fine, right? At the end, you know how much knowledge, information you have. For me, it's like taking this structure, educational qualification is a way to force me to actually keep learning. And also in a way, like I still need to learn in order to pass exam assignment or stuff. So even though like I don't really enjoy it, but I know like at the end of the day, I do gain some knowledge from it. So it's really like see whether the career, like the aspirations, like your career aspiration or what you're looking to do in the future. Ask the people working in those areas, in those fields, do they have a CFA? Like what kind of jobs that require CFA? What kind of jobs that don't need a CFA? Like ask them so that you know more what it is. And really, like, is it for your personal, like your personal development? Do you find it would be helpful or do you find like, no, this is just not for you? And another question is how to improve in math. For me, is I think at the end of the day, it really comes down to practice and the ability to connect the dot with your previous information so that you can build on your knowledge and it's like logical thinking. So math sometimes is not easy. It's definitely not easy. So sometimes it's like you have to go through the material many times in order for you to understand something. And you have to go through the material in many different ways for you to actually get it. So I don't have a real answers for this. I think it's like train your brain and also like practice so that you're gonna get better in it. I don't think practice make perfect, but practice can make you feel less overwhelming when you approach new things. So that is what I think becoming an actuary give me, is when I have to go through all of these things and going through like studying and working on the tech. It give me it helped me build habits. It helped me like feel more confident in my ability to learn new things because I know I can do it. Other people can do it. I can do it too. It's possible. Nothing is impossible. So it's like the confidence, the positive mindset, like that is like becoming actually gave me. And that's also how like I continue to do more education, because I know like even though it's hard at first, the new material and everything, I know if I put in the effort and then like having the right strategy or technique, I can master them, or like at least I will be able to learn them. So the next question is, does CFA after FSA help your career if you don't work in investment? So as I mentioned, I think it is helpful if you work in the risk area, but do you actually have to take it? I don't think you actually need to, because like you can learn things on the job. But I'm always interested in the commodity finance area. So this is some, and I enjoy structure learning. That's why I go through the like getting another designation. But you know what? Like after my last exam level 3, after I walk out of the stadium where I wrote the exam, I was telling myself, I'm done. I'm done with taking another qualification or designation exam that like I have to spend 6 months or whatever many months that is, and my exam result, like the result is determined by one exam. That's yeah, I'm done. I was like, I'm not gonna do that anymore.
I'm done.
So I think it's also depend on what you want to get out of it, and can you get the information or the knowledge from other channel, like especially these days with a lot of alternative courses, finance courses or investment courses that you can do online. So like master of finance or master quantitative finance, like also different options as well. So like for me now, I only want to do like education in like programs like that, so that like I have assignment over time and learning. Like it's just like much less pressure compared to like studying for 4 or 6 months, and yeah, you will have to, and if you pass, that's great. If you fail, you have to go through the process again for 4 to 6 months. At this stage of my life, I don't want to go through it again. So yeah, I would ask like what you actually want to get from it. Do you actually need it after you having the FSA? I think if you want to stick with the actual career path and in the traditional field, I don't think you need to. But is it an added bonus, especially for certain role? Yes, it is. Okay, so I guess that was really my rant on thinking about learning and studying. And I guess it's been more than 5 years since I finished all of these exams, and it's perfect memory when I started talking about them. So sometimes we just emotions took over a little bit, and yeah, I just want to share with you my honest opinion and feedback about these. So hopefully you find them helpful, and let me know what your opinions are. And again, all of these are totally my personal opinions. And yes, it's gonna be very biased from an opinion of an actuary. So again, if you find them helpful, don't forget to like and share, and then subscribe if you haven't done so. And I will see you in another video. Bye now.